If you think it's too extreme to call this genocide, I want you to listen to the leaders of Israel themselves. The defense minister called Palestinians animals. Another government minister said there's no such thing as non-combatants in Gaza.
If you want to read genocide definition,
another top Israeli army official said human animals must be treated as such. There will be no electricity and no water. There will only be destruction. Where's my sign? This is why we say, this is why Bob Avakian says, Israel has done something truly incredible. Israel has managed to turn Jews into Nazis.
This is pure anti-Semitism.
No, this is not
anti-Semitism. You can't call me Nazis.
Did it say all Jews? Did it say all Jews? If the shoe fits, wear it. My family is Jewish. My family had to flee from Poland to get out because of the pogroms. My grandma came to this country in 1929, right before the Roundup and the Holocaust. Okay? And the lesson of the Holocaust is never again for anyone. Down with the racist apartheid state of Israel! And its master, U.S. imperialism!
That was Rafael Kadaris, a RevCom and a regular contributor to this, the RNL Revolution Nothing Less show, out at a campus in the greater Los Angeles area. This is the RNL Revolution Nothing Less show, the one and only show that each and every week brings alive the need and the basis for a real revolution for the emancipation of humanity here and the world over in these perilous times. And this is the 177th episode of the RNL show on December 14th, 2023. My name is Andy Zee and I host the show, and I want to welcome everyone watching along with Sunsara Taylor, the co-host of the show.
That's right, and I want to welcome everybody listening on our podcast as well. We are coming to you in very extreme times. We're going to start today's show off by looking at the intensifying genocide being inflicted on the people of Gaza by Israel, back to the teeth by the U.S., and the importance of the struggle against this and the repression that is coming down on people. Andy will be talking with Rafael Kadaris about that. He's out on the East Coast right now. Later in the show, Atlas Winfrey will bring you an update on the UN COP28, the UN Conference on the Climate, that was a complete fuck you to humanity's future and to this planet. A big PR job, acting like they're going to do something about the climate while they intensify its destruction.
Sunsara, then you're going to be doing a segment on the vicious ruling by the Texas State Supreme Court to deny Kate Cox the right to get an abortion, even as she is pregnant with a fetus that has a fatal disease and is likely herself to suffer serious, even life-threatening complications if she's compelled by the courts to continue her pregnancy.
And at the heart of today's show, we are going to bring you an excerpt from the interview that we did here on this show with Bob Avakian, the revolutionary leader, the architect of the new communism, who we root this show in his leadership, and we are fighting for the revolution that he has re-envisioned and the communist future that he has re-envisioned. We're going to bring you a section of the interview that we did with him, where he talks about why this is a rare time when revolution is more possible. And then Annie Day will join us, and she'll talk about a campaign we are launching for a grassroots movement, spreading these interviews, watching them across this country, and why that is so important right now.
All right, Sunsara, we're going to start today's program with the struggle that's going on the campuses and throughout society in this country to stop Israel's genocide of Gaza and the U.S. and genocide Joe Biden backing this up. We began today's program with our frequent contributor and member of the RNL crew, Rafael Kadaris, speaking on a campus here in Los Angeles.
Down with the racist apartheid state of Israel! And its master, U.S. imperialism!
And then earlier this week, Raymond Latta, a RevCom and a spokesperson for Revolution Books in New York City, was in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, joining a protest there against genocide Joe Biden.
This Biden is coming here to raise funds for his genocidal program, and we are standing opposed to that. And he thing. People are standing up to the people of Palestine, doing it courageously and heroically. And they are standing against the genocide taking place in Gaza, and they are exposing the hand of U.S. imperialism in this. And students, artists, and intellectuals are coming under fire for this. The hammer is coming down from the Republican fascists and from the Democrats, the warmongering Democrats. And what we say is that people must continue with this struggle, not back down, and at the same time, people have to go deeper, look deeper at the cause, the root of what's happening, and that is the imperialist system. Bob Avakian, the revolutionary leader, said, we can no longer afford to allow these imperialists to dominate the world and determine the destiny of humanity. They must be overthrown as soon as possible. And I call on all of those who are standing up, whose hearts are with the people of Palestine, who dream and yearn for a better world, a radically different world, to join with the REVCOM, the force that is actively organizing for this revolution at a time when this revolution is more possible.
Down with genocide, go!
Down with Nazi!
Down with Nazi!
The people be revolution.
The people be revolution.
Thank you.
Both those points that Raymond Lada just made are incredibly important. The need for people to stand up against the genocide in Gaza and against the repression that is coming down on those who have spoken out, artists, intellectuals, students, and others. And the need for people to look into the roots of this horror, to look into the roots of this war and this genocide in the system of capitalism, imperialism, most of all the U.S., and yes, its pit bull in the Middle East, Israel. It's attack dog. So in a moment, Andy is going to be interviewing Rafael Kadaris about both of these themes, but before that, we want to show just a little clip of Rafael. He's out on the East Coast right now. Here he is in this clip outside Harvard University, taking on the doxing truck that is driving around Harvard University, exposing the personal details of students who've stood up against this genocide and calling them Harvard's leading anti-Semites.
Look at this fascist truck right here. This truck that's doxing students on this campus, suppressing pro-Palestinian voices. Why can't Jews have some protection on this campus? Why can't the Palestinian people have some protection in Gaza right now from having 2,000-pound bombs and hellfire missiles raining down on them? Are Jewish students on this campus being bombed? Are they being put in concentration camps? You know who is? The people in Gaza right now. Anti-Semitism is a very real thing. But what these people are doing is a bunch of bullshit. It is changing the subject from the actual genocide that is happening right now.
All right, so that was Rafael Kadaris, a regular contributor to the RNL Revolution Nothing Less show. Rafael survived the cold, and he's still in Boston, and we want to welcome him to the show. How you doing, Rafael?
Hey, I'm doing well, and good to be here.
Yeah, well, we were really excited that we made a decision as soon as we heard about the congressional hearings that dragged the president's of MIT and Harvard, where you are in Boston, Cambridge, and as well as the president of the University of Pennsylvania, who was compelled to resign in what was a congressional inquiry to put these college presidents on the docket for having not sufficiently suppressed the struggle of the students to stop the genocide in Gaza. Now, I wanted to ask you, you left here right away, as soon as you heard about this, what was your mission, and what have you found when you got out there to Boston?
Yeah, well, first of all, I don't think people fully realize what a big deal it is when You know, when a fascist congressperson, sort of like the McCarthyite trials back in the 1950s that were going after communists, but now they have, you know, this, you know, fascist MAGA congresspersons, Elise Stefanik, by the way, a supporter of Trump's fascist coup, for her to drag these, you know, three presidents of major Ivy League schools, you know, Harvard, MIT, Penn, and actually force the resignation of the president of UPenn. This is a big deal. And what were the terms that were being set in these hearings? You know, they basically, you know, they asked, probably many of you have seen the viral clip of, you know, Stefanik asking these presidents, will you, you know, is it against the school policy if, you know, students call for the genocide of Jews? But what you didn't see is that previously in those hearings, you know, Stefanik had defined calls for genocide against Jews as just saying intifada, which is an Arabic word that literally just means uprising or shaking off of oppression. You know, they said you can't say from the river to the sea, Palestine will be free. Otherwise, you're calling for the genocide of Jews. This is complete nonsense, you know. And in fact, you know, the screaming irony of this whole situation is here you have a movement, a righteous movement of students on these college campuses and across the country who have been demanding a stop to a literal genocide, which has been going on for over 2 months now, 20,000 civilians killed, over 10,000 children, almost the entire Gaza Strip completely destroyed, almost everyone in that whole area displaced from their homes. This is ethnic cleansing. This is literal genocide. And the people who are opposing this are now themselves being accused of genocide. You know, this is a vicious lie and a slander, and it's designed to suppress this movement of opposition, which, you know, has had an effect. You know, it has actually ripped the veil off the U.S. and Israel and their claims of democracy and human rights. People have called out genocide Joe Biden. They've said that the state of Israel is a racist apartheid state, and they're right to say that, you know, and the people who are saying that anti-Zionism is anti-Semitism are wrong. You know, there's nothing anti-Semitism about opposing, you know, the criminal racist state of Israel. In fact, as Bob Avakian said, after the Holocaust, the worst thing that has happened to the Jewish people is the state of Israel. You know, and this is something, you know, that you had lots of Jewish students and Jewish people in society who've said never again should mean never again for anyone. I came out to the East Coast to, you know, salute the students who have been standing up to this and say, look, we have to take this struggle further. Now is not the time to back down in the face of this repression. You know, now is actually the time to broaden the resistance, to make the resistance even more militant as the state of Israel and the U.S. continue to bomb the hell out of Gaza, you know, and this repression comes down on people. And now is the time for people to ask the deeper questions about why is the U.S. backing Israel? Why have they backed Israel for decades under Democrats and Republicans? What does that have to do with the nature of this system of capitalism imperialism? You know, in U.S. imperialism in particular, the world's number one gangster, and the special role of the state of Israel serving the interests of U.S. imperialism in the Middle East and beyond. That's why it's not just the Jewish lobby, as people might think, you know, or the military industrial complex. It's imperialism and this special role. And so people have to, you know, we're challenging students on these college campuses to dig into the deeper root causes of this genocide and the real solution, which is nothing less than revolution.
You know, in just the last 2 months, you can see that the consensus, in a certain sense, of people just going along with this, they don't really like Biden, and but they're kind of going along with things and really not liking Trump. But here, there's been a tremendous delegitimization of imperialism and of the Democrats as the alternative. I wonder if you've been talking with students about that.
Yeah, you know, I think there is, you know, we've met a number of very serious students who are really agonizing about the situation in Gaza right now and are feeling themselves, you know, we just came from a rally at MIT where, you know, a lot of students feel very you know, even personally responsible for what's going on in Israel, because, you know, MIT actually has many, many contracts with the Israeli Defense Forces producing weaponry and equipment that they use to carry out this slaughter. You know, so there is a tremendous depth of, you know, moral responsibility that a number of students that we've met feel, you know, and many of them feel like, you know, they're really up against, you know, this system. And the fact that, you know, as much as we've been protesting, as much as they've been speaking out, these politicians just don't seem to be listening at all. And even more than that, they're now coming down on them with, like, you know, repression. Many of these, a number of these students have been arrested. They're facing disciplinary hearings, federal investigations. All this is going on these campuses. So it is actually forcing a lot of students to ask the question of why. And people have actually been open to what we have to say on this. And what we're actually trying to bring out to people is, look, the essence of this country and this society, you know, as Bob Avakian says, right in the beginning of the book, Basics, the essence of what exists in this country is not democracy, but capitalism, imperialism, and political structures to enforce that capitalism, imperialism. And what the U.S. exports around the world is not democracy, but imperialism and political structures to enforce that imperialism. The essence of this country is a dictatorship. You know, for all their talk about free speech and, you know, democracy and all this kind of stuff, you know, when it comes down to it, when you threaten the core interests of this system, which Israel is, Israel, you know, plays a key role serving the core interests of U.S. imperialism in a very strategic part of the world, the Middle East, where a lot of oil is produced. It's a crossroads of global trade in the Middle East. The U.S. has used Israel to have its talons in that region and beyond for decades. You know, so when you have people delegitimizing that state, you know, saying it's an apartheid state, that's very dangerous for this system. And so people are right up against, you know, this is not a democracy, you know, in essence, this is a dictatorship that's on full display right now. And, you know, we've had people also looking, you know, I just talked to someone today who said, you know, she asked me if I was a communist. And I was like, I am. They were like, oh, that's really cool, because all my friends hate capitalism, but no one, you know, and I'm just looking at this genocide being carried out. I'm learning that my phone is, you know, produced by child labor in the Congo. You just pull one string and the whole, you know, all your beliefs about this system fall apart and you see the whole system is rotten. But all my friends, you know, feel that way and they're hopeless and they don't see any alternative. And so I was like, well, look, we have an alternative. You know, and there's leadership and Bob Avakian, who's got a whole new understanding of communism and a constitution for a new socialist republic in North America and a strategy that we can fight for now, you know, particularly at this moment when millions of people are being dragged into political life right now, you know, by this genocide, by the fact that a party in this country has become an openly fascist party and the other is a party of, like, grotesque war crimes and genocide. Like, these are not our only options. You know, our choice is, are we going to accept this system and everything it does to humanity and the fact that it's pushing the climate of our planet off of the cliff and bringing about fascism in this country? Or are we going to get organized to overthrow it now? Mm-hmm. You know, and that's the challenge that we're putting to people. And, you know, it is a challenge because revolution is not on the radar. It's not the comfortable thing. It's not the easy thing, but it's the necessary thing. And that can speak to people in a moment like this.
All right, Raf, keep it up and you keep us posted on your travels on the East Coast. And we'll see you when you get back here.
All right. Sounds good, Andy.
All right. Bye bye.
All right, so it was really good to see Rafael out there in Harvard Square, out in the action, and good to hear the interview you did with him, Andy.
Yeah, you know, Raf made this point about the importance of this resistance, and we spoke some about the need to take it further, to not be backed down, and, you know, we wanted to play a Instagram from the just tremendous world-class artist Residente. He's a hip-hop artist from Puerto Rico. He's a filmmaker. He's a musician. And he posted this message on Instagram. Watch it.
Bueno, Les cuento a todos los que les interesa mi música que desde octubre decidí posponer la salida de mi disco junto con varios videos que se suponía que salieran este año porque se me hace imposible hacerlo frente a todo el genocidio macabro que destruye lentamente a Palestina. No me siento bien, me duele demasiado, pienso en mi hijo todos los días y no puedo ser indiferente ante esto. Y me pregunto, ¿cuándo fue el día en el que nos deshumanizamos a tal nivel que podemos ver cómo explotan las cabezas de niños y niñas enfrente nuestro y no decimos nada? En vez de subir un story modelando ropa o mostrando el plato de comida que te estás comiendo o la noche de fiestas en donde te emborrachaste, te detienes por un momento, buscas información sobre Palestina y denuncias el genocidio que está cometiendo Israel con el apoyo de Estados Unidos contra la población civil de Palestina, porque son civiles a los que están matando. Esto no lo hago desde el lado del reproche, sino que desde el lado de la decepción como artista, porque como artista me entristeció el ver que durante toda la premiación de los Grammys nadie dijo nada sobre este genocidio, nada. Y entiendo que hay gente que no dice nada porque no entienden sobre el conflicto, pero a ver, díganme, ¿qué es lo que hay que entender que es tan complicado? No hay que ser un historiador para ponerte en el lugar de cada persona masacrada en Palestina. Es simple. Esto se trata de tener empatía, de ponerte en el lugar de los demás, de pensar en los demás, de pensar que ese niño que acaban de matar puede ser tu hijo o tu hermano, o que esa mujer debajo de los escombros puede ser tu mamá. Entiendo también que hay mucha desinformación, porque pues yo pasé por eso, pero es nuestra responsabilidad el educarnos. Por ejemplo, yo crecí bajo la propaganda de los medios masivos en Estados Unidos, que nos educan para que pensemos que todos los palestinos son terroristas. Por eso, cuando yo de chamaquito escribía Atrévete, no tenía ni puta idea de lo que ocurría en Medio Oriente, me salió esta línea que ya está cancelada en mis conciertos, que va a explotar como palestino. Me da una vergüenza cabrona haberla escrito. Bien cabrón, ¿pero qué hice? Pues me empecé a educar, a entender, a conocer lo que sucede realmente en Palestina, en Gaza, a entender el pueblo y la lucha palestina y su deseo de vivir libremente en su país. Por eso fui a grabar en Palestina el video de Multiviral y cuando filmé el video de guerra salí con una bufanda palestina que me habían regalado cuando estuve allí. Y también en cada concierto, cuando nos lanzan banderas palestinas, siempre las cuelgo en tarima como muestra de apoyo porque ya sé lo que ocurre. Mis colegas y amigos que yo admiro y que quiero no tienen que tener miedo a ser cancelados porque apoyando a Palestina están del lado correcto de la historia. A los artistas que siempre han denunciado todo en todo momento, que ustedes saben quiénes son, sigan haciéndolo porque cada vez que lo hacen me inspiran a mí y inspiran a los demás, yo lo sé. Necesitamos que todos se unan y pidan un cese al fuego de inmediato, porque cada niño asesinado hoy en Gaza estaría vivo si hubiesen dejado de bombardear ayer. Libertad para Palestina. Y los veo el año que viene.
All right, so we want to urge you to watch the full statement from Residente. You can find it on his Instagram feed. We just gave you a portion of it, but the entire thing is quite moving and important right now. So far in this episode, Andy has spoken about, Raymond Lada agitated in the streets of Philadelphia about, and Rafael got into both the need to take the struggle against this genocide in Gaza further, but also the need for people to look into the system that is driving this nightmare, the system of capitalism, imperialism, and to get with the revolution that is needed to overthrow this system. Andy also made the point that we are in a rare time when not only is this revolution more urgently needed than ever before, it is also more possible. And this is something that is not at all obvious on the surface, but it's really important to understand scientifically. So a year ago, a little more than a year ago, when Andy and I had the chance to sit down with Bob Avakian and interview him on this show, we asked him about why this is a rare time when revolution is more possible. He had just spoken about the war in Ukraine, and we're coming off of that, and I asked him about this rare time. Let's watch. Well, I'd like to ask about how this threat of war, open inter-imperialist war, World War III, nuclear war, relates to the rare time that we're in, that you have analyzed, that we're in a rare time when revolution could be possible.
Well, I think what it does is underline the urgency of the situation. It just, you know, puts it in very sharp relief that, you know, actually making revolution. I mean, you can imagine if you made revolution in this country, what the effect that would be in the world as a whole, including for the masses of people in these other imperialist countries, whether you're talking about Germany, France, and so on the side of the U.S., or in Russia or China, for that matter. Imagine in China, which, you know, still pretends to be socialist. It hasn't given up the pretense. Imagine if there were an actual revolution, you know, working to, you know, to establish socialism in this country. Imagine the effect on the masses of Chinese people, as well as the people in Russia and people throughout the world. So, you know, this underscores the urgency of the situation. Now, you know, there could be urgency without possibility, and that, of course, would be very bad. But as I've written, you know, in the work you referred to, something terrible or something truly emancipating, there's also what's going on within this country with the divisions within the ruling class, which are unprecedented, haven't happened, you know, before, since the Civil War, essentially. And, you know, these are getting sharper all the time. And now left to itself, of course, that's very bad. It can only lead to a very bad outcome because one of these, you know, one section of the ruling class represented by the Republican Party is an openly fascist party. It's openly white supremacist, misogynist, patriarchal, male supremacist. You know, right down the line, it's like openly and aggressively, you know, insisting upon oppressive relations and the violence to back that up. You know, and, you know, repeatedly you hear, you know, Republican Party politicians encouraging violence while they have this base of millions of people out there who are, you know, chomping at the bit to commit violence to get rid of all this stuff where, you know, any kind of possible concession of any limited kind to the struggle against white supremacy, you know, and male supremacy and so on. You know, they just, you know, they can't stand the idea that, you know, gay people are out of the closet and now there's just trans people asserting their rights. They just can't stand this. And to them, you know, this they regard this as existential. They regard this as a way the country is going that is totally unacceptable to them. It's not worth living in if this is the way the country goes, even with these minor concessions, while all this oppression is by no means eliminated and is, you know, powerfully enforced by the workings of the system. But even minor talk about concessions to it is too much for them. And as I pointed out, you know, when we were talking before, you know, this is driven by Christian fundamentalists, Christian fascists. Let's not call them Christian nationalists. Yes, they're American chauvinist nationalists, but they're fascists. They're Christian fundamentalist fascists, you know, who want a theocratic society. That means a society ruled by religious authorities, namely, you know, religious authorities of the type that they are and that they recognize as legitimate. That's what they want. They want, you know, what's that Boebert, that congresswoman, you know, said, you know, that we shouldn't have any more of this separation of church and state. The church should run the state. The church should dictate the terms of the state. I'm paraphrasing, but that's pretty close to her exact words. You know, so this is what, you know, this is all out of the closet now, if you want to use that term. Or another way to put it is it's all out of the basement. You know, I referred to this before. Richard Pryor, I think it was the 70s, maybe it was the 80s, but he used to have this routine talking about fascists, Nazis. Nazis were the particular fascists in Germany, but they're, you know, means the same thing. And he had this routine where he'd say, you know, brothers say, I ain't scared of no Nazi. Hey, Mr. Nazi. And Richard Pryor say, no, man, if you see a Nazi, you're going to be running as fast as you can. And then he goes on, he says, you know, they got all these people chained up down in the basement. He said, you don't want anything to do with those people. You don't want those people off their chains and out of the basement. And guess where they are? They're off their chains and out of the basement. You know, and they have no intention of going back on their chains and back in the basement. So this is, you know, one section of the ruling class and one part of society aligned with them and, you know, following their leadership, you know, but in a, you know, a mutually influencing relationship. It's not just a Republican say you do this and then they do it. It's like, I mean, we'd have to go into more about Trump and everything, but just really quickly, Trump broke all the rules when he ran for president in 2015, 2016. You can't say bad things about John McCain. He's a war hero. Well, he did. They said, that'll be it. You can't do that. Guess what? He kept right on going. And he broke all the rules. You know, he openly called for people to be beaten up at his rallies and all this kind of stuff. He openly promoted violence. You know, and he said himself, I could murder somebody on Fifth Avenue in New York City, and all my supporters would still support me. And lo and behold, they have. You know, he hasn't quite murdered anybody yet on Fifth Avenue. But, you know, he had the Access Hollywood tape where, you know, he openly talked about sexually assaulting women. You know, well, you know, maybe for a day it was like, oh, you know, and I remember one of his supporters who became his press secretary, that Kaylee McEnany. You know, she did this whole routine. And it's interesting to see what her routine was in defending Trump. She said, we're all sinners in the eyes of God, but we've been washed in the blood of Jesus. So therefore, Trump, you know, will be forgiven. This is her line she ran out. This is Christian fascism, okay? That's what these people are. And, you know, that's all on one side, and that's heading toward a very bad place. But the reason why there's a positive potential here, it's not been realized yet. When I say something truly emancipating, that's the possibility which has to be seized on. But the reason I say that is because this is breaking down all the established norms of the system, all the ways in which people have been conditioned to go along with the system and believe that by playing by the rules, you know, things will work out all right. You know, the peaceful transfer of power. Well, we should understand, what is the peaceful transfer of power? It's the peaceful transfer of power from one section of the ruling class, represented by the Democrats, to the other section of the ruling class, now represented by the Republicans, or vice versa. Well, Trump, you know, even as early as the 2016 election, made clear he wasn't going to go along with that. And then in 2020, it took a whole nother leap, you know, where he didn't go along with it. And, you know, and he came, as people point out, came very close to actually pulling off a coup and remaining in power. Not just with January 6th, but with the whole effort that he made. And still more is coming out about what was involved in this attempted coup. You know, and so this is all, you know, breaking down the norms of the system. And those norms have what conditioned people to, you know, to believe that you just go along with the way things are. You may not like how they're going now, but then you, next time you have a chance to vote. You know, and I see all these commentators coming on, you know, And you know, making good analysis of this Christian fundamentalism, although they won't call it Christian fascism. But then what do they end up saying? Well, you know, we have the power to stop this because we can vote. But look what's happening to the vote. You know, you have fascist officials in many of these states, you know, the crazy way the U.S. is set up as the United States of America, not a single country. I mean, it is a single country, but it's a country composed of different states, each of which has their own laws. You know, right now there's a bunch of states that are making legalizing marijuana, but for a long time, you know, there was hardly any. So, but you could go to a different state and smoke marijuana, you know, but then if you took it back over the border with you to another state, you'd be in big trouble. That's the craziness of this country, okay? Besides, you know, because they had all these different colonies in the first place. Some of them were based on slavery. Some of them had slaves, but they weren't so much based on slavery. And they had to figure out how to put it together. So they put it together as an amalgamation of states. And it took them a while, a couple of tries, to get even a strong federal central government. So, you know, the reason I'm raising that is you got all these different states where you got all these fascists in office now, including the crucial offices that oversee the elections. And you got legislatures controlled by Republicans in many states who are openly saying, if we don't like the results of the election, we'll just invalidate them. We'll say that they're no good, and we'll just cast the electoral votes for whom we want to get in there. So even more than usual, I mean, voting in this country is voting for one or another section of this, you know, horrendously oppressive ruling class anyway. But now it's even less meaningful, even more meaningless to vote when you have all these Republicans who are not even going to allow the election. I mean, 2020 was a, as some people have pointed out, a dress rehearsal. You know, and they're preparing, if the election doesn't go the way they want it, just, you know, talk about stop the steal. They're prepared to steal it in any case, and to do it, quote unquote, legally, by having the legislatures and the, you know, the secretaries of state overseeing elections and the courts backing them up. Now, let's remember, if there's a dispute about what's legal or not or what's constitutional or not, where does it go? To the courts. And where does it ultimately go? If, say, you go to one lower court and then you go to an appeals court and they overturn the lower court, where does it go then? To the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court is controlled by fascists. That's who just rendered the verdict overturning Roe v. Wade, which had been nearly 50 years a constitutional right for the whole country. That's, you know, the ultimate decider now is the Supreme Court, and that's dominated by fascists. And that, you know, think about the effect of that ruling overturning Roe v. Wade and the shockwaves it sent and the way it angered people. Well, things like that are going to continue to happen. And that's going to shake up a lot of people and make them much more open to questioning what's going on here and why do things, you know, falling apart and being torn apart like this, and what's the answer to this? And that's where the revolutionaries come in and providing the answer, in uniting with people in resisting outrages and struggling against oppression, but most of all bringing to people the basic understanding of what is going on here and how this conflict in the society overall, including at the very top among the opposing sections of the ruling class, can provide openings for us to actually go at the whole system and holds the potential for the splitting apart of its dominant institutions, even the ones that carry out violent suppression of the people rising up. So this is what we mean when we say something terrible or something truly emancipating. But the truly emancipating has to come from us, has to come from the revolutionaries, it has to come from the people who catch hell under this system all the time, and it has to come from people who want justice in the world, even if they aren't catching the worst hell all the time. They have to wake up and recognize that their mission is not to get behind one section of the ruling class or another. And especially now, to recognize and seize on the opportunity to put revolution on the map, and then build on that, involving thousands and then ultimately millions of people to shake the whole society to its foundations and every institution in the society. And when those conditions ripen, then to go for the whole thing.
That was Bob Avakian from the interview that Sunsara Taylor and I did with him last fall. And I'm here with Annie Day, who's the executive director of the Bob Avakian Institute and a frequent contributor to this, the RNL show. Welcome, Annie.
Thank you. I'm very glad to be here.
All right. You know, we want to talk about these interviews. Mm-hmm. There's three interviews. They're on our site, YouTube, at the RevComs. And I know that you feel very deeply about these interviews and the power that they have and the transformative power they have for people. And we're about to initiate a grassroots movement so that the tens of thousands who've seen this so far become hundreds of thousands and millions. And that's going to require all of you to be a part of this. And to kick this off, I might as well announce it now. This is the last show of the fourth season of the RNL show. And the next 3 weeks, we're going to be playing each week over the Christmas holidays and into the beginning of the new year, each of the three interviews in succession. So I'll talk about that more with Sunsara at the end of the show. But this is part of kicking off this grassroots movement. But Annie, because you do feel deeply mm-hmm. about this and as part of the Institute, a key part of the Institute for the Bob Avakian Institute, I'd like to hear you talk about it some.
we live in a really dark time, and I think there's a tremendous amount of hopelessness. And what comes through in these interviews with Bob Avakian's voice and his vision and his leadership is that there's a whole different way humanity could live. We could actually make a revolution and tear this beast of a system down. We actually could relate to each other in a whole different way. We can be, you know, and he concentrates this very serious, very determined about making an actual revolution and maintaining all the heart, all the humanity, all the joy and the poetic spirit that comes through in these interviews. How we could go to work for revolution, what shaped him from, you know, things that will surprise you, from doo-wop to Shakespeare. There's really nothing like this in terms of people being able to envision a different way the world could be, meet a revolutionary leader who's brought forward the strategy for revolution and a vision for, like, for real. We could live differently. We could relate to each other differently. We don't have to be all dog-eat-dog set against each other. And the potential for that and the vision for that and the framework comes through in these interviews.
Earlier in today's program, we were showing and talking about these young people, especially who've been out protesting and the genocide that's being committed against the people of mm-hmm. Gaza, the Palestinian people, including on the West Bank, and thoroughly backed up by the U.S. Imperialism. And, you know, we talked about genocide Joe Biden, and we had Rafael Kadaris on this show. So there is people out there right now fighting back against this system, trying to stop this genocide, but they don't know, they haven't seen that there's actually a way to get rid of this system, and that another world is possible. There's a different emancipating way we could be living. And that's all what comes through in these interviews. So there are all those out there, like you said, who are demoralized, who are mixed up and, you know, hurting themselves in various ways, got their head in the sand. But then there are these other people who are coming into political life. These interviews need to connect with both of those sections of people. That's going to give them a sense that we don't have to live like this, that there is another way than, as you said, a strategy for an actual revolution that's in here, and actually a vision of that future society. Bob Avakian's written a constitution for the new socialist republic in North America. And in this interview, I ask him, well, why did he do that? And you really need to see the answer to that.
Yeah, I mean, that's actually one of my favorite parts of the interview, is that whole discussion about the rule of law under socialism and the role of this constitution for a new socialist republic in North America, and the concreteness of that vision really makes you see how it's possible to live a whole different way. I mean, I think on, you know, in the clip we just watched, BA says that that's something truly emancipating, the potential for that, that has to come from us. And the people you're talking about seeing these interviews, the people I'm talking about seeing these interviews, if this was spreading throughout society right now, if people were engaging this, if people were gathering together to watch it, to debate it, to you know, have it provoke and challenge them in the ways that it can, and in the ways that only BA can, it could change the political landscape in a really big way, because I think people are, even the angry ones, mm-hmm. even the protesting and defiant ones, there's still a lot of agonizing about, you know, feeling that there's no way out. And the more these interviews were spreading and being engaged and debated, I think that can change in a pretty big way.
That's exactly right. We need a situation, and it's possible to get a situation. If you watch these interviews, we're going to have them on the next three shows every Thursday night for the next 3 weeks, each of the three interviews. Watch these interviews. You feel that potential that we could be living a different way. And then something exponential can happen, which is very related to changing the world. People taking this up, getting it in front of groups of people, getting it in front of your friends. You watch it, you send it to a friend. You say, I'm going to talk to you tomorrow. I'm going to talk to you in an hour and a half. Let's talk about it. And then you're developing the ways that geometrically the tens of thousands who've seen this so far can become hundreds of thousands of people. And that has to happen soon because of the extremeness of the situation we face. A grassroots movement around these interviews. That's what we need. That's what's possible. And we're calling on you to be a part of that, and beginning with the next three shows.
Yeah. And when you do that, you are introducing people to the need for revolution, to the possibility for revolution, how that could happen in this time. And you're getting to know and introducing people to the leader we have for this revolution in Bob Avakian, and there really could be nothing more important in terms of the potential for humanity to have a way out.
Over the last week, a 31-year-old woman from Texas named Kate Cox has been at the center of a legal battle. She's been fighting for the right to get an abortion that literally could save her life. Kate Cox had gotten a heartbreaking diagnosis from her doctor that her much-wanted pregnancy was doomed. The fetus was diagnosed with trisomy 18, a condition that is often fatal to the fetus or leads to a newborn who usually dies within weeks. But this pregnancy was also a danger to Kate Cox. She was in and out of the emergency room four times. So a lower court in Texas initially granted her an exception to the state's fanatical anti-abortion laws. But Ken Paxton, the Christian fascist attorney general of Texas, immediately challenged this ruling. He insisted that anyone, any doctor, or anyone else who assisted Cox in getting the abortion she needed could face prosecution, with potential penalties of being stripped of their medical license or even thrown in prison. Then, on Monday, the Texas Supreme Court backed him up. They ruled in his favor, stating that Cox was not close enough to death to qualify for an exception. She wasn't close enough to death. Let's stop right there. Any system, any country that would do this to a woman, and not just to one woman, but to let this hang as a threat over the lives of millions of women, any system like this has no right to exist. We also have to say right here and right now that Ken Paxton, the Texas Supreme Court, and really the entire so-called right to life movement has officially forfeited any right to ever again speak in the name of life or in the name of babies. I mean, this was always a lie, because fetuses are not babies, and abortion has never been murder. But in this case, it's all just hanging right out there. There was virtually no chance that Kate Cox's pregnancy would even survive. Her fetus was destined to die, either in the womb or after intense suffering and the cruel torture inflicted on Kate as she watched this unfold very soon after being born. But even that is not all. Kate Cox herself was at risk of dying if she continued this pregnancy. So much for the preservation of life when it comes to a woman. And what about Cox's two actually existing children? Where did the needs of these innocent children to have their mother stay alive factor in? They didn't. You see, these so-called right-to-lifers have no claim to the mantle of life or the so-called well-being of children. The reality is that the fight over abortion has never been about babies. It has always been about controlling women. It has always been about slamming women backwards. It has always been about punishing women for the ways that in recent decades they have broken out of their traditional place as property of men, breeders of children, and baby-making machines whose desires and dreams and very lives are expendable to this male-dominated patriarchal society. And let's be clear. Kate Cox is not the first woman whose life has been shattered or threatened by anti-abortion laws, and she will not be the last. Since the Supreme Court overturned the right to abortion last year, 14 states have banned abortion. And just yesterday, this same fascist-packed Supreme Court announced that they would hear a case that could drastically restrict access to the abortion pill, even in states where abortion is technically protected. The abortion pill is one of the most common and safest forms of abortion in this country. But at every point, as this war on women has escalated, the Democrats and the so-called pro-choice organizations who are slavishly attached to these Democrats keep acting like this can never get worse. Even as these rights, even as these ways of life that millions and millions of women have built their lives around and come to rely on are shredded. And all these Democrats and these so-called pro-choice leaders keep insisting that you who are outraged by this, you who are insulted by this, keep playing by the rules of this system. They keep insisting that the most important thing you can do is get out and vote. But when the rules of the system empower women-hating, dark-ages, predatory pigs like Ken Paxton and the rest to completely shred fundamental rights that generations of women have come to rely on. When the rules of the system empower fascist courts to rule over and dictate women's enslavement and even potentially their deaths. When the rules of the system are set up so that even abortion protections passed at the state level can be swept aside like tissue paper by fascists at the federal level, then it is time to stop accepting and playing by the rules of this system. It's time to break out of restricting yourself to voting and relying on this system's bourgeois electoral bullshit. It's time to stop accepting this system as legitimate at all. As long as we are forced to live under this system, people need to stand up against and defy these attacks on women's rights and their very lives. But we need a revolution. We need a radically different system. We need a society and a world where nothing like this could ever happen again. So dig into the Constitution for the new socialist republic in North America, written by Bob Avakian. Lift your sights to the kind of radically different world and society that is possible, and join the fight now to make this real. Women are not incubators. Women are not property of men. Women are full human beings. And right now, to quote Bob Avakian, women have a tremendous role to play, not only in making revolution, but in making sure there is all the way revolution. The fury of women can and must be fully unleashed as a mighty force for revolution. And now, in his own words, this is Bob Avakian speaking to this from his work, Something Terrible or Something Truly Emancipating.
Here is another profound truth. Even with all the ways that the heavy chains of hundreds and thousands of years of oppressive tradition weigh down on the masses of people and place a heavy burden, particularly on the half of humanity that is female, there is a deep yearning to be free of all this, which not only leads to imaginary hopes of supernatural salvation, but also erupts in unrestrained fury right in this real world. And that fury needs to be fully called forth, given a scientific revolutionary expression, focused toward the emancipation of all the oppressed and exploited of the world, and ultimately all humanity, directed to fighting against the fundamental source of all the suffering. This system of capitalism imperialism, with its suffocating and brutal patriarchal male supremacy, along with all its other outrages. This takes on even more powerful meaning and urgent importance in the current situation in this country and others, where the forceful assertion of raw misogyny, hatred of women, and patriarchal subjugation of women is becoming more blatant and unbridled, focused to a significant degree now in the escalating moves to even further deny women control over their own lives and their very bodies, with the right to abortion and even birth control being brought under mounting attack. Right now, this slogan and call needs to be taken up broadly and made a powerful material force. Break the chains. Unleash the fury of women as a mighty force for revolution.
Tiemble el estado, los cielos, las calles, que tiemblen los jueces y los judiciales. Hoy a las mujeres nos quitan la calma, nos sembraron miedo, nos crecieron alas.
Two days ago, the COP28 environmental conference came to an end with newspapers heralding it as an outstanding victory for the climate because they finally have agreed to use the words fossil fuels. This is nothing more than a sham that these countries have been running for almost 30 years now.
For 30 years, countries have been meeting and signing non-binding, non-enforceable agreements, pledging to reduce emissions, all while they continue to increase emissions that are rapidly warming the planet. For 30 years, they could agree to talk a big game about decreasing emissions, but have refused to take steps to phase out fossil fuels, the primary cause of global warming. They talk big about increasing renewable energy, like wind and solar, all while they massively invest in new oil and gas projects, like Biden giving a permit for the Alaska Willow Project, the single largest oil drilling operation ever carried out on public land. Or like the president of COP28, the CEO of an oil company who is investing $150 billion, that's B for billion dollars, in new oil drilling projects. He got exposed for trying to use the conference as an opportunity to sell oil and gas. And get this, this year's COP28 allowed a record number of oil and gas lobbyists into the summit, some 2,456 of them to be exact. This year, both the hottest year on record and with fossil fuel use also breaking record levels, the COP28 agreed to sign another non-binding, non-enforceable agreement that calls for transitioning away from fossil fuels, but refused to include any language about rapidly phasing out fossil fuels. They struck down any language that calls for stopping construction of new coal power plants, and their statement promotes the use of natural gas as a transitional fuel. The science is clear that we are already here, already at the point of no return, the threshold of irreversible and devastating changes to the Earth. And it was a 12-year-old climate activist who got up and exposed this COP28 for what it is. Not a climate summit, but a fossil fuel summit. A summit to keep the burning of fossil fuels going and to continue destroying the Earth and continue destroying any hope for our future. As Bob Avakian has said, this system and those who rule over it are not capable of carrying out economic development to meet the needs of the people now, while balancing that with the needs of future generations and requirements of safeguarding the environment. They care nothing for the rich diversity of the Earth and its species, for the treasure this contains, except when and where they can turn this into a profit for themselves. These people are not fit to be caretakers of the Earth.
Okay, Sunsara, that brings us to the end of this 177th episode of the RNL Show. And yes, the end of the fourth season, but we have a lot coming up over the next 3 weeks.
That's right. We want to remind you before we close out that the next 3 weeks we are featuring on our channel every Thursday one of the segments from the BA interviews that we did here. Part one will be next week, then two, then three. And we want to call on you once again to gather friends, gather family, spread these and share these interviews with people throughout the holiday season.
Yeah, and stay tuned to our website, to our social media, and to our YouTube channel, including as you watch these three episodes that are going to be each one of the interviews, as you just said. We may be including a little introduction depending on events in the world, and there could be dispatches that we put up on the channel. And then on January 11th, we begin a very pivotal and fateful year, when revolution could be possible, when things are coming to a head in this country with the elections of 2024. And that's going to require some changes, and we're going to make some big changes in line with big plans for the next year. So that's January 11th.
That'll be our first episode of the new season.
That's right, season number 5. But before we close out today's show, there's a couple more things we've got to talk about.
Donate to our channel, donate to our show, and donate to the revolution. You can make a contribution, a regular contribution to this show at patreon.com/therevcoms. You can do $3 a month, $10 a month. This is how we keep this show going, and it needs to grow in the new year. And the end of the year is the giving time of year. And so we want to ask you to give generously to the Movement for Revolution and to take this out to others. Make a gift in the name of somebody else as a holiday gift. Let them be part of changing the world this year and ask them to donate as well. This is the time people give the most of the year. So please join in fundraising efforts in the next 3 weeks with us.
And then on January 7th, we're going to have a fundraising webinar. This is going to be very important to kick off the new year with a lot of funds. So, yes, the end of the year, giving season, give a gift to the revolution. Donate then, and then start the new year off in the right way and participate in and donate to the webinar on January 7th. And then we'll see you for the first regular show of 2024 of the RNL Revolution Nothing Less show on the 11th. Of January.
And thank you to the whole RNL Revolution Nothing Less crew here in the studio and for the whole season.
I join in that. Thank you. And I want to say this holiday season, make it a holiday season for revolution. We're going to be out in the streets. We're going to be putting on these three special shows of the interviews with Bob Avakian. We're going to be raising funds for the revolution and looking forward to 2024, a year when we really get down on building the forces and bringing forward the people, the thousands, for an actual revolution. So with that, we'll see you next week at the RNL show on YouTube.